Politics by Aristotle. Book 1. Every state is a community of some kind, and every community is established with a view to some good, for mankind always acts in order to obtain that which they think good. But if all communities aim at some good, the state or political community, which is the highest of all, and which embraces all the rest, aims at good in a greater degree than any other, and at the highest good. Some people think that the qualifications of a statesman, king, householder, and master are the same, and that they differ not in kind, but only in the number of their subjects. For example, the ruler over a few is called a master, over more, the manager of a household, over a still larger number, a statesman or king, as if there were no difference between a great household and a small state. The distinction which is made between the king and the statesman is as follows. When the government is personal, the ruler is a king. When, according to the rules of the political science, the citizens rule and are ruled in turn, then he is called a statesman. But all this is a mistake, for governments differ in kind, as will be evident to anyone who considers the matter according to the method which has hitherto guided us. As in other departments of science, so in politics. The compound should always be resolved into the simple elements, or at least parts of the whole. We must therefore look at the elements of which the state is composed, in order that we may see in what the different kinds of rule differ from one another, and whether any scientific result can be attained about each one of them. He who thus considers things in their first growth and origin, whether a state or anything else, will obtain the clearest view of them. In the first place, there must be a union of those who can't exist without each other, namely of male and female, that the race may continue. And this is a union which is formed not of deliberate purpose, but because, in common with other animals and plants, mankind have a natural desire to leave behind them an image of themselves, and of natural ruler and subject, that both may be preserved. For that which can foresee by the exercise of mind is by nature intended to be lord and master. And that which can with its body give effect to such foresight is a subject, and by nature a slave. Hence master and slave have the same interest. Now nature has distinguished between the female and the slave, for she is not niggardly like the smith who fashions the Delphian knife for many uses. She makes each thing for a single use, and every instrument is best made when intended for one and not for many uses. But among barbarians no distinction is made between women and slaves, because there's no natural ruler among them. They're a community of slaves, male and female. Wherefore the poets say, it is meet that Hellenes should rule over barbarians, as if they thought that the barbarian and the slave were by nature one. Out of these two relationships between man and woman, master and slave, the first thing to arise is the family. And Hesiod is right when he says, first house and wife and an ox for the plough. For the ox is the poor man's slave. The family is the association established by nature for the supply of men's everyday wants, and the members of it are called by Charondas companions of the cupboard, and by Epimenides the Cretan companions of the manger. But when several families are united and the association aims at something more than the supply of daily needs, the first society to be formed is the village. And the most natural form of the village appears to be that of a colony from the family, composed of the children and grandchildren, who are said to be suckled with the same milk. And this is the reason why Hellenic states were originally governed by kings, because the Hellenes were under royal rule before they came together.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.